Hey guys, it's Julesie, and we are back for another video. Today, we will be talking about, as you can see by the title, how pretty privilege is not real. And we are discussing this because our definition of pretty privilege is typically a way for us to distill the violence of anti-blackness. It negates the actual bigotry that is always current when the term is used. And by bigotry, I mean colorism, featureism, transphobia, and ableism, amongst other things. Pretty privilege often allows us to evade our own and others' participation in upholding a system of anti-blackness. Now, before we get into this, first, our sponsors. For my regular degulars, my returning subscribers, most of you already know that I have a sponsorship with Scentbird. And Scentbird is a monthly perfume subscription. I am absolutely in love with it because I've been getting into the luxury of perfumes. And of course, I definitely have a coupon code. If this is your first time getting into Scentbird, use my code Julesie3 and you get 30% off your first month. And I'm absolutely a fan because, as I was saying, get travel scents sent to you each month. Now, if you are new to the game of scents, one thing you will learn is that buying scents that are extremely popular because everyone mentions them and everyone claims to love them, and especially these more expensive luxury scents, which is what Scentbird sends you, you quickly will have your feelings hurt when that scent does not fit with your body profile and you have a big bottle of it. So I absolutely love being able to explore different scents in these trial size containers, twist off, and you can pop the scent out itself to see which one it is. This is Vincent Camuto Florel. It's giving pink peppercorn, red orchard, sparkling bergamot, pink vanilla, and cedarwood. Let's spray it. I love it. It's floral without being too springy because it has that undertone of sandalwood in it. And this is absolutely a scent that I will be using. Skylar Clean Beauty, their scent, Pink Canyon, which is grapefruit, pink salt, and cedar. I think this is one. And look, I love this bright color. I don't have no coffee beans, so let's spray it over here. This scent is very interesting. I want to spray this on my skin and see how it really, really sets in, because this is more mature. You know, I love me an old, decadent, Upper East Side white woman scent. Three scents, super dope. And these are also great as holiday gifts to get your people. And you can always go on the website if you find a scent you like and purchase the full size through Scentbird. So again, use my code Julesie3 for 30% off your first month. And let's get into how pretty privilege ain't real. Again, as I said in the intro, we are discussing pretty privilege because I recently did a TikTok, well, then I reposted it to Instagram and to YouTube Shorts, about the colorism that exists on Real Housewives of Potomac. I know we talk about light skin privilege and light colorism, but Giselle is like the true blue embodiment of what I think a lot of us are getting at when we want to highlight light skin privilege. And I mean, that video is three light skin women, and I don't think the privilege lands the same way for each of them in the way that it so specifically works so well for Giselle. She's tacky. She can't dress. Her house is ugly. And she can't dance. She's incredibly mean. She got back with the man who was sleeping with the entire congregation, having babies on her. And there is no stigmatizing shame the same way it works for other Black women. Giselle walks this world like she is owed everything and will run after you if you deny her of anything. And that's the closest I have ever seen a Black woman get to moving through this world like a woman. And her wigs are still tacky. The way we got carried together and she out here.
The amount of people that commented saying, oh no, it's just pretty privilege. It's just pretty privilege. It's just pretty privilege. And it's like, how does that negate colorism? What even is pretty privilege? Why are we using that to deny a system of oppression that members of our own community participate in? Why are we using that to remove responsibility? What I wanted to do, though, is explore how are we even using the term pretty privilege? Where did it come from? And why I have fully landed on it's not a real thing. Largely, I think people use it to deflect from actually naming the systems of harm that are actually taking place. But let's get into this. Etymology, 2006 academic paper, Why Beauty Matters. Harvard economists, Marcus Mobius, and I'm sorry if I mispronounced that man's name. It's here on the screen though. And Tanya S. Rosenblatt, sorry to her too, found that, and I'm quoting here, physically attractive workers are more confident and higher confidence increases wages. Two, for a given level of confidence, physically attractive workers are wrongly considered more able by employers. Three, controlling for worker confidence, physically attractive workers have oral skills, such as communication and social skills, that raise their wages when they interact with employers. And then Mobius and Rosenblatt go on to reference another study from 1994, where economists, and I'm about to butcher all these names, Daniel Hammermesh and Jeff Biddle found that that workers of above average beauty earn about 10 to 15% more than workers of below average beauty. The size of this beauty premium is economically significant and comparable to race and gender gaps in the U.S. labor market. Now, I would like to call out how that last line in particular is super interesting, that the study makes only a single mention of race. This is the only mention of race in the entire paper. And they mention race as being an indicator variable, but none of the actual data isolates race or any other actual observable characteristics in the findings. They actually never distinguish what comprises of someone being considered more attractive. What are the common denominators? So then the problem with the first study that I mentioned, Why Beauty Matters, that it uses a construction of beauty that is the mean of the rater's overall centered beauty ratings. This, both studies absolutely fail to account for the set of features that actually makes somebody beautiful. We don't get any mention of race, of skin tone, of physical disability or ability, of body size, shape, hair, or eye colors. We don't get a mention of any of these studies. And again, I mean, let me also clarify, because I know I do have an international audience, these studies are referencing the United States of America and our labor force. And word to Toni Morrison, there is no language without racial language. And so even though, as the study calls out, a beauty premium does actually point to some observable social imbalances, it does nothing to break down what those actual imbalances are. So what we then get from these studies is that when these papers were done in 94 and 2006, and even within that time frame, we know that the evolution of beauty standards changes as it does between 2006 and 2021, because we never address what those particular indicators are. We just broadly are now saying, oh, well, subjectively, if you are perceived as beautiful, you're going to have, and most of us know from our own lived experiences, especially those that sit at a multitude of intersections, that just claiming someone is beautiful doesn't create the same metric of social imbalances that this study is implying. But because these studies never get into what the actual physical indicators are, and we know in America there are absolutely physical indicators, what is the utility of this? These studies tell us how beautiful people are treated, but never actually tell us what beautiful people look like. And take a moment, like, think about it. If we were to actually notate what the qualifiers were, what would we be confronted with? In order to trouble this idea of pretty privilege even more, I want us to get into the complicated definition of the pretty and the ugly. I want to reference Deshaun Harrison's In the Belly of the Beast, The Politics of Anti-Fatness as Anti-Blackness. And in this book, they speak of how prettiness, with a capital P, is a set of structural advantages over someone who is ugly with a capital U. Ugliness with a capital U, then, in the United States, is a set of beauty standards steeped in, you guessed it, anti-blackness, anti-fatness, anti-disfiguredness, which is also anti-disabled, and cis-heterosexism and ableism. So prettiness with a capital P isn't simply a particular aesthetic. It is a set of implicit metrics that determines someone's value in society. The perceived value often determines our material conditions and our quality of life. Our distance from blackness, our distance from fatness, our distance from queerness, our distance from disability is what gives people better access to medical care, housing, communal and intimate partner safety, education, and often determines how we interact with the carceral state. There's so many ways my brain wants to deviate here, because even when we have this conversation about the overrepresentation of Black men in mass incarceration, beauty or prettiness is defined as a feminine quality. Think about the construct of gender identity. You can't talk about racism without talking about how white people structure gender as antithesis to the Black man and Black woman. And as Harrison points out in their praxis, ugly with a capital U is someone who does not have access to desire capital. So they don't embody the identities that grant one access, power, and resources. Even if y'all think like I'm too theoretical here, it's too up here in the sky, like we understand on a real intimate level, like in our day-to-day lives, within the communities that we live in, that even in the bodies that we embody, for most of us, that being fat, dark-skinned, poor, visibly poor, disabled, gender non-conforming, non-binary, or trans has a real implication on your ability to access basic human rights. If people perceive you as not being of a specific means, of not having a certain access, and a lot of those ways we assess a person that we don't know, whether they're worthy of our time or not, is based on the visual. Harrison does go on to reject the idea overall of pretty privilege or prettiness, and we're lowercase p here, as a privilege. And they see this concept as a framing that implies that someone can opt out of systems of harm associated with certain identities, whether it's being wealthy, thin, white, cisgender, heterosexual, able-bodied, whatever. The concept of pretty privilege then sets up this metric that says if a person does not feel pretty, does not feel confident, that they then opt out of the privileges that they access. And conversely, that if the capital U ugly simply buy in to the beauty standard, that they then can access the privilege of safety that comes up in this metric. For fat people in general, a common thread when they are talking about the harm, the literal harm that comes into their life because how they are perceived as a fat person, and they are told, just have some confidence, just buy this, just wear this, just present yourself visibly this way, and that will somehow alleviate the harm you're experiencing. Neither personal insecurities or endless amounts of confidence are going to be able to undo systems of harm. And you just simply cannot buy your way out of these, like, hear me, when I say system, these are not individual things that are happening simply between individual people. We might perpetuate the system in our interpersonal interactions, but these systems, you know, I want to reference Dr. Collins, the hegemonic domains of power. Typically, these systems are embedded in our cultural, political, domestic life institutions. Like, it's overlapping, and it's not a pursuit of one individual taking it on. Of course, this gets around to how pretty privilege is connected to capitalism. And pretty privilege absolutely plays into capitalistic and neoliberalistic tropes that there must be winners and losers. And when I say neoliberalism, it is a system of politics, and politics is not always just simply government, but even personal politics. But it's a system of politics, of beliefs, that we understand the systems of oppression, we understand the systems of harm that exist in our society. But rather than say we need to abolish these systems, we flip it around to say no, individuals need to just work on themselves. And oftentimes this neoliberal flipping of responsibility from the institutions to the individual also feeds into a capitalistic approach. Because anytime we are telling people that it is an individual problem, we are oftentimes selling them a literal product on the other end of telling them they have a problem. Because when we create tropes that say that there must always be winners and losers, we then are also consistently telling the people that lose that they have done something, they've done something wrong or not done enough, and essentially that they deserve to lose. We look at poverty. We say that people have not worked enough, that they are lazy. Even though we are experiencing a class stratification coming out of this pandemic. And I think a lot of people got a wake-up call about how little social services there are to support people when the bottom falls out, but then we're told, oh no, you're the reason you're poor. This is how we twist it, and rather than look at the institutional structures that embedded these systems of oppression, we flip it on the individual. And when we bring this back to the overall themes of pretty privilege, in the age of social media, and you know, the favorite mention, the Kardashians, and the ever popular Instagram face, which I did a video on last year about the danger of filters, beauty is absolutely always for sale. Staying ugly is seen as a choice that should be punished. How our beauty politics are absolutely set up on capitalism and what can you buy. We also exist in a society that has absolutely ingested this idea of domination, of dominating one another. When we talk about these systems of harm, we also have to talk about how seeking punishment against others is embedded in our culture. This significantly impacts fat, trans, and gender nonconforming people. And people who occupy these bodies, especially when they are also Black, are seen as defiant. Maybe people would treat you better if you lost some weight. What did you expect would happen if you transitioned? Even the way we might talk about, oh, I don't want my child to be XYZ because I don't want them to have to deal with the harm. And then we get people who actively fix their socially undesirable traits and they are rewarded and praised. Now, obviously, we can think of the Kardashians, we can think of the social currency that Kylie, even Khloe, have gotten from, you know, Khloe Kardashian's revenge body, or, you know, the entire transformation Kylie went through, and even framing it as something to be sympathetic of because, oh, they have such a beautiful older sister in Kimberly. But even when we look at who gets to be represented in the trans community as acceptable, as desirable, or even the social currency that they get from it, the pursuit of beauty is extremely costly because beauty standard is constantly evolving. There is a constant commodification of beauty standards and beauty rituals. We could even look at the history of makeup and beauty vloggers on YouTube. And I mean, I was definitely on the fringe of this with the strong eyebrows in the 2010s, but that full beat face. I remember having this conversation about how YouTube opened the doors for non-traditional people to become popular, to become stars and celebrities even, but then quickly it just became District One about who could own things. Like, everyone looked a little funky when they first started out, but we all, and I mean, this is an indictment on myself again. I'm not doing any of these videos thinking that I'm above any of the things that I talk about, right? But that we all participated in the commodification of the otherness or the weirdness that YouTube initially allowed to rise to the top on the platform. And everyone just started to have the same veneer of wealth. Everyone started to buy into the same veneer of wealth, even in our homes. And I had to make a conscious choice. You know, this is why I like, it's wildly colorful in my backgrounds at all times. Cause that white and gold has content creators in a headlock, all right? When mirrored furniture was everywhere, headlock, chokehold even. We see how beauty fuels multi-million, sometimes billion-dollar industry. And it's not just makeup, right? Because I was pointing out the 2010s of makeup. Makeup got even more expensive, and it shifted from people using drugstore makeup to using high-end and investing in luxury beauty as a standard. The uptick of skincare was a response to the over-commodification of the makeup industry that YouTube influencers sprung out of. People were doing skincare because it's like, well, I don't have to buy into all these products. I could also not buy into the fact that I am attached to these products as being confident with myself. So I'm going to invest in my skin. But, oh, you know, that very quickly, like skincare isn't even just about products, but skincare and the idea that like someone has good skin to live a highly stressed, impoverished life and walk out and look radiant, look glowing, you know, this idea now that our natural skin should have no texture or should have minimal texture, should be radiant and glowing The skincare industry evolves into the plastic surgery industry and not even, I mean, the plastic surgery industry evolved throughout the spectrum that I'm specifically talking about within the realm of YouTube. People were getting breast augmentations and now we're in the era of BBLs, which I recently did a video on, but even Botox and facial injections. It's the thing. It's just the thing everybody does. And because of that, plastic surgery has become even more accessible. Even easier for us to suggest that, oh, you just need a little bit of this. You need a little bit of that. You know, you'll be all right. It's always been something commodified. And it's not that people don't have the means to buy into some of these other industries that have been uplifted as, oh, this is how you buy into beauty. And more specifically, how you buy into desirability. But like some people, regardless of what they buy into, still going to be seen as like that sort of capital U ugly. And tourism and home decor allows them even a modicum of access, some of the standard of beauty and desirability, because the backdrop in positioning yourself in backdrops that signal wealth, whether that is traveling to specific locations or having a very nice kitchen, allows people to perceive you as desirable. And that's as close, unfortunately, as some people get to being able to buy into the conventional beauty standard. It's really easy to understand how this concept of pretty privilege being allowed to exist and how us using pretty privilege to evade naming actual harm allows it to be suggested that, oh, you just have to be seen as desirable and you too can access the privilege. You too can have it. To bring back around to pretty privilege and harm, when beauty equals worth, invariable harm will absolutely happen for those who cannot engage in these very specific beautification rituals. No, I'm not saying, oh, if you don't get plastic surgery, you're gonna have harm in your life. I'm actually implying that it's much more pervasive than that. As I mentioned earlier, the insecurity versus confidence paradigm, you know, or how often, you know, fat people go to the doctor and are told that their medical issues are just a symptom of them needing to lose weight. This insecurity versus confidence paradigm absolutely highlights how the socially ugly with a capital U are often have to compensate for the systematic violence and interpersonal harms they encounter by investing in confidence. Just buy these right clothes that fit you better. Why did waist trainers become so popular all of a sudden? And sometimes that even just looks like an investment in a capitalistic frame of self-care. I'm not saying that anything of these things are inherently wrong, because honestly, I don't think there's any way to live in society and you do not buy into some sort of commodification of beauty. I'm sitting here, I got eyelashes on. I got eyelash extensions. I have makeup on. I have my hair done. You know, I own a Peloton. There are absolutely things that I have invested in that I have bought for my own pleasure, for my own want. But I just want to allow us to think a little bit deeper about what do we believe comes from our ability to buy into these things. It's more so to be able to give people the language so that we can name harm rather than negate it, rather than deny its existence. And that if we name specifically these systems of oppression, we are better able to dismantle these systems. Thanks for getting into this video. There's so many other ways that I could keep going on about this topic, but I just want to always encourage us to name the harm, name the systems of oppression, and don't allow people to tell you that you can just buy your way out of said systems by spending your money with them. Don't get got. Thanks for watching. Thanks to Scentbird for allowing to make this video happen. And thanks to Reb for helping me co-write this video. Deuces!